Let's see. Jim George is in the studio. Jim is the owner of American Cable Services, and one of the reasons he comes in here is so that if you've got a question about some of that new technology that's out there, he's here to answer those questions. So let me give you the phone number if you don't already know. It is 622-9622, 622-WOCA. That is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline. And I guess that's it. Good morning, Jim. How you doing?
Good morning.
Doing fine. Thank you. Can you hear me?
See, even I need to remember technology. I need to remember to turn the knob up. Otherwise, we won't hear you. How you doing?
Exactly. I'm doing good, thank you. But it's Valentine's Day today. I heard all the conversation.
It is a distraction, for sure.
Or Galen. I'm talking about a frustrated guy, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I didn't realize, you know, how much anxiety this day causes everybody. Yeah,
you know, well, after 39 years of marriage, my wife and I have it down to a science.
Wow.
Basically, we're going to skip today. Mm-hmm. And tomorrow, when everybody's all over it, we're going to go to a matinee movie.
Okay.
Some chick flick that she wants to see.
Uh-huh.
And do you know what it is?
No, it's her choice.
Okay.
And then after that, we're going to go out to dinner. So maybe an early dinner, maybe 5 o'clock. And then I get home about 7:30. Oh, we'll always stop by someplace and have a nice cup of coffee, maybe a cup of the Irish or something. You
see,
know?
That does sound nice.
No, that's a perfect date.
But now here's the thing that I just noticed, that the man who can put home theaters into all of our homes is going to an actual theater.
Well, yeah, that we do that about once or twice a year.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's wonderful. Yeah, Jim. You're
it's
romantic.
The experience. My wife's a popcorn fanatic.
Uh-huh.
I mean, every night she pops popcorn. Every night.
Really?
Yeah. So she likes
in the microwave?
I bought her an actual popcorn popper. That's a nice Valentine's Day gift.
Oh.
It's got a big round.
You bought it for Valentine's Day?
I bought it for Valentine's Day about 5 years ago, and she even said last night, it's amazing, she said, this is the best gift you've ever given me.
Wow. Okay.
And it makes good caramel popcorn, too. You put the caramel on the top and the peanuts in it, and it pops the popcorn and does it automatically. Oh, it's good.
Wow.
Good.
And then we make popcorn with coconut oil instead of margarine or something
it's
like that.
It's healthier, right?
Very good. Very good.
Excellent.
So, yep, it's going to be a good day tomorrow. Today's work.
It's listed as one of the things to improve your libido is coconut oil. We didn't get to it because there was so many distractions, but it was on the list.
No, we eat it for everything. My wife fries her eggs in it, so when I have eggs in the morning, we have it with coconut. And if we fry anything, we use coconut oil.
And have you noticed a difference? Yeah. Does it taste better?
It does. And if you ever want a fruit salad, you know, like if you're doing the cut up oranges and pineapple and all, you know, throw some shredded coconut on top. Very good.
Oh, wow.
Very
good.
You
gotta try that.
Hmm. Yeah, the coconut keeps you alive.
So this is the day. You know what I noticed about Christmas and Valentine's Day is old movies seem to be the favorite movies.
Yes.
People like these old movies. So I wonder if there's any movies that come out today or like this time in 2014. That will really be more favorite in like 2034. Yeah. You know what I mean? Or 2054 or something.
Well, last Valentine's Day, we have Madam X, the old one.
Oh, really?
The middle one and the last one. There's three, the remake of Madam X. And we sat there and watched all three of them in a row.
Who enjoys them? Or your wife or both?
I enjoyed them also. It's a great movie if you don't remember the theme behind Madam X, where she left her husband because mother-in-law didn't like her and so on. But the son grows up to be an attorney and
John
he has
Forsythe.
To represent her. And it's a tearjerker. Mm-hmm. Women love it. They, I can't believe you. And so it's great.
It's a good one.
Have you noticed this ever happening in all the years you've been working with people's home entertainment systems where you'll get more calls because of a special event? Like people, the Olympics is coming up. I got to get this cable. I got to get this system or I got to get this digital recorder, that kind of thing.
We do know that people are last-minute Joes. What I mean by that, they have all year, let's say, to have something installed, but they'll wait till the last day to call you to do it. This whole week has been nothing but hurry up and get it done. Everything from the American Cancer Society called me in Gainesville, which is the Hope House. If you're not familiar with the Hope House, everybody's heard of the Ronald McDonald House, where you go and you get to stay for free because you're having medical stuff done to you. Well, Winn-Dixie owns the Hope House. It's in Gainesville. It's a huge place. Probably 50 people can stay there. It's like a hotel. And groups come in three times a week and make dinners and such, but you're allowed to bring your own food. You have your own kitchen, your own everything, and you stay there free while you're having cancer stuff done for you at Shands or the VA hospital. So they called me. They had an emergency. So I went up there. It was 2 days. I worked the day before yesterday until 8:50 at night. They locked the doors at 9, so I had to get out of before 9.
Oh, wow. Yeah, wow.
And then I worked yesterday until 5 o'clock. And then another nursing home called me down in Lady Lake, and I had to run down there and fix their nurse's call system. That was an emergency. Their wander guard system wouldn't work. That's the magnetic doors that you're not supposed to go out of.
And,
they had fixed according to the fire marshal. It took me 3 days to fix that.
Wow.
So you do security too then?
I do security, a fire alarm, burglar alarm, all that stuff.
Wow.
But more for institutional. It's very seldom that a homeowner will call and want something done. They can call a lot of the alarm companies or Shamrock here in town. There's a lot of good local, security companies that will install a security system for you, and they'll monitor it for you. I do commercial work.
Wow.
I used to work for an assisted living facility, and I remember those alarms that would go off when doors that shouldn't be opened were opened. And I remember one time they broke down. And so what I'm getting at here is I asked the question, well, how did we do it before? Because it was broken down and everybody was panicking. And so the answer was simple. We walked around.
Yeah.
We looked. We kept going one door to the next, and there was a constant having to look. And I don't know.
Wow.
I think I'd rather be looking all the time. That way the people feel like... The people who are living there feel like, oh, you're visiting me. Yeah, how you doing? Yeah, just make sure you're okay.
You know, the doors have to open automatically in case of a fire. So one of the tests is they would go pull the fire alarm. They would first announce over the intercom that this is a test. Then they would pull the fire alarm. And then the magnetic doors have to open automatically, so let people out. Well, that part was broken. So you can see where the fire marshal and OSHA and everybody would be on.
Oh, it's the exact opposite of what I thought you meant. I thought they were opening and not sounding an alarm.
No, well, everything was broken. I'm saying that part didn't work. You're supposed to be able to lean against a magnetic door for 15 seconds. And if you lean against it for 15 seconds, it should open up automatically.
Really?
It's got a magnetic lock that will hold 600 pounds of pressure. But in case of emergency, in other words, you don't know the code. Mm-hmm. Like a fireman's got to get in. A fireman will lean against the door for 15 seconds, and it will open up automatically. It will sound the alarm.
Yeah.
So there's all kind of things that have to be done. So the programming of the box is harder than the installing of the part.
So when you those businesses, do you also put in the television cameras so the people can monitor where the alarms are, doors?
We put the closed-circuit TV cameras in a lot of places. So we did the Hampton Inn, the new one on 200 that was built here last year. We put the cameras in there.
Wow.
We do all the high-end electronics that out-of-state people have to come and do. So we're right here locally.
So has the snow in the Carolinas affected the operation you have up there in Boone?
Nope, not really. It's self-contained. Everything's running, fine. The way any system should work is if you install it, it should run flawlessly. If there's any problems at the beginning, they're going to magnify themselves at the end. But if it's installed right the first time, it just runs and runs and runs until nature takes its course and a part just dies. And then you replace that part and you go on.
Oh, wow.
Simple as that.
Oh, my gosh.
Yesterday, there was a man asking for money. And I honestly didn't have any cash on me. So I said, well, let me go into the convenience store. I said, what do you need it for? He said, I need to get a room at the Salvation Army. So I said, you have to pay? I know you pay to the Salvation Army. So anyway, long story short, I called the Salvation Army. They said, well, the beds are all flooded because of all the rain. I said, what rain?
Yeah.
Anyway,
beds are all flooded because of the rain.
Yeah. So then I said, really? She said, well, what's your name? I said, it's not for me. It's for this guy standing here. He's asking for money so he can stay. I said, when did you guys start charging? She goes, oh, it's free if he comes right now. You got to get here before 5. All of a sudden, well, I thought it was flooded.
Yeah, she had
it. It just reminded me of, I know it's got nothing to do with what
you're
doing.
I was just remarking about technology in general, and this may sound crazy, but one of my biggest peeves is the toilet paper dispenser in a bathroom. It seems like they put, like this is commercial establishment, so you have a large toilet. Great. you got the handicap rails.
Right.
Fantastic.
Right.
Where's the toilet paper? Below your knees. Do they hire midgets to come in and put these things
in? That's funny.
I mean, it should be above where you can get to it.
That's true. What's the matter with those people? Yeah, you're right. You gotta contort your hand just to get it.
I mean, you gotta contort to get down to get a piece of toilet paper. Well, they put it at eye level where you can see.
It is a piece. Nobody uses a piece, do they?
No.
A square. Come on.
And you start to pull it and it breaks like every 5 inches. Come on. So, I mean, for Valentine's Day, someone needs to reinstall those things.
Did you get your wife chocolate? No. You're just going to the movies?
No. I got her a nice card. And like I said, we're going to go out. Tomorrow's our day. Mm-hmm. You see the rush should be over.
You see the big heart behind me? That's for Fun with Joe later on.
Oh, Fun with Joe.
Some lucky winner going to win the big heart.
Fantastic.
Do you also install the security when the residents are in the bathroom? Those little things that you push the
buttons?
That's
part of the nurse's call system, yeah.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yep, they pull that and it closes the circuit and the circuit sounds an alarm. And the way it's supposed to work is it should tell you which bathroom they're in, not just the fact that a bathroom was pulled.
Right.
Because in some nursing facilities, there could be three wings.
Yeah, right. Uh-huh.
And it could be multiple bathrooms, you know. So you have to know exactly where it is. Same thing with the bedside when they push their button. Mm-hmm. It just can't say room 719. It's got to be, is that A bed or B bed? So all this intelligent stuff is just keeps me busy all the time. Reading manuals and programming all this stuff, and I'm about ready to stop that. I think a couple of more years, or maybe one more year, and I'm going to be out of the new technology business. I'll do all the stuff that anybody wants done. That's 2015 and back.
You're tired of filling your brain with new information.
It's unbelievable how much you have to learn. It is literally unbelievable. I have I just took a test that I failed. I got to take it again, but it had two books. They were 5 inches thick, 8.5 by 11, printed on both sides of the paper, and they asked you 500 questions, and there were over 5,000 pages that I had to read, and I missed by 4 questions.
Oh, no.
So now I'm going to study again.
My goodness.
And there's always different questions because it's computer generated.
5,000 pages.
Yeah. You know, just to keep my certifications up, not to get new certifications, just to keep up what I already have.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know,
I wouldn't know the answer to one question.
So after a while, you just got to stop. You say, forget it. I'm no longer certified in that thing. Fine. You know, but right now I'm certified in over 250 different. I do Bogan sound systems. I mean, you have to be certified by the manufacturer. You got to be certified by the technology.
So. Yeah. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
So that whole test incorporates everything, then.
It does. Yeah. Yep.
Wow.
You got to be certified in everything. And everything has technology to it. Even the grease pits right now, you know, remember the restaurants? They have their own grease pit outside.
Right.
Yeah. There has to be sensors to tell when to empty that thing.
Oh,
that's
my
all
gosh.
Technology.
Oh, they can't see it anymore?
Well, if they want to go out and open up the trap, they can see it.
My goodness.
So what happens when people come to apply for a job working with you? What kind of certifications do they need, or are they allowed to train on the job?
It would be great if they had their certifications before they come, but the one criteria we have whenever we interview, and I go to the MTI, Marion Technical Institute, and I'm there every year talking to the students, and plus at the end of the year they have a job fair where we sit there and the students come and apply for a job to us. It's more of an exercise than anything. How are they dressed? How do they act? The one thing I ask them is, tell me what you're reading, and if you know what books are you reading, and so. And if they are not a reader, they can't work for us.
Oh my gosh, I never thought about
that. Because everything we do is reading. Every manual we have to read, every installation, you name it, it's all about reading and comprehending.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And yet when I was in school, I was probably the worst reader there was.
Oh,
I would have never thought. You know, you remember how you were in school and they say, what are they making me do this for? I'll never use it.
Uh-huh.
You'd be surprised how much algebra you use and trigonometry and don't even realize you're using it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the distance between here and there and estimating this or estimating
that. That's true. Yeah,
all that is
true.
Math.
Well, and my argument with the kids who were trying to make that, because I was always in favor of learning, even if it wasn't something I would learn, I would use, is that it exercises your brain. I mean, everybody understands the importance of exercise. Well, thinking exercises your brain.
It does.
By the way, on this date in history, according to the calendar that Robin's daughter Shannon gave me, in 1876, Alexander Graham Bell filed an application for a patent for the telephone.
Mm-hmm.
Gosh. Are you an inventor? Also, no. I've never asked you that question.
No, I'm inventive, but I'm not an inventor.
Hmm. Yeah, but being inventive is probably better than being an inventor, yeah, because sometimes you got to work around things.
Exactly. You take other people's inventions and you figure out how to incorporate them into something you're doing.
Ah.
You know, like you had that little camera, for instance. Let's assume if we could have it on a train track that was going around. And you could station it, you know, anywhere you wanted to and aim it, you know. That's using technology that's already out there and just being inventive on, how to make it work the best for you.
I saw a train like that. I saw a train, and if you look at the TV screen that you gained the picture through that camera, I'm saying it wrong, but anyway, it looks like you're watching a real train.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's so small.
Very unique.
Oh, what should people look for when they're going to ask you to come in and set up your system so they can get items a la carte, plus they want the great sound possible and the great television? What should they look for the entire package? Because that's kind of, you know, confusing.
Well, the TV delivery is one aspect of it. The second is the TV itself. Mm-hmm. So they should determine what their expectations are. What are they expecting out of that? For instance, I had a 35-inch TV up until Christmas. You know, last year I was telling you I bought a big one. Mm-hmm. I was very happy with it. But now that I have a 65-inch TV, whoa, I don't know how I ever looked at that 35.
That's crazy.
Wow.
And so we did not change the distance we were sitting from the TV. So doubling the size, you know, doubled, let's say, the pleasure of watching TV.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
So that was the first thing. We had an option. We could move closer to the TV, which always gives the illusion of having a bigger TV.
Oh, okay.
I mean, you're looking at a little, 12-inch monitor.
Mm-hmm.
If you had a 36-inch monitor there in front of you, imagine the difference it would be.
I wouldn't be able to see you.
Wow.
I'm having a hard time now looking over the screen.
Well, imagine if you were wearing Google glasses. Mm-hmm. You had your glasses
right,
but the display was in the glass. And everything you wanted to see on the screen was right in front of you.
Be distracted.
Oh, my gosh.
It would be. But the idea is when you're focusing far away, you can't see what's in front of you. And as soon as you change your focus, you see what's right in front of you.
Yeah, right.
So there's all kind of, you know, technologies out there. I wouldn't want to wear them. I have to wear glasses for reading, and I hate putting them on. I just carry them with me, but I hate putting them on. So the first thing is to determine what it is your expectations are of your TV. So once you get the sound that you like, I mean, the size of the TV you like, the next thing is the sound.
Mm-hmm.
Because the flat screen TVs, the speakers usually are out the back. So they hit the back wall and then bounce. So it sounds like there's TV everywhere. I mean, sound everywhere.
Oh.
But it's not really clear.
Mm. Yeah.
So that's when they sell the sound bars that go in front.
Which I was demonstrating one, but playing with one over at Best Buy. And I love those things. They sound good, too.
They sound good.
Mm-hmm. Are you ready for a phone?
Yep.
All right, we have a call. Good morning. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning, everybody. Do those 65-inch flat screen TVs, do they use a lot of electricity, like, let's say, compared to a 40-inch flat screen?
It depends on two things, the make and the model, and how you set it up in your setup. For instance, my wife and I, when we set up our 65, we can have it where it's really always on, so when you hit the power button, it comes on instantly. Or you can have it where it's off. There's drawing no power at all, and when you turn it on, you got to wait about 3 to 5 seconds before it comes on. So the idea is we have it till you have to wait for the 3 to 5 seconds to come on, because it's not drawing any current. It's turned off.
Well, what's best for the longevity of the TV set, to have it on all the time or off?
The new ones don't really matter that much. The old plasma screens, I shouldn't say old plasma screen, they still have new plasma screens, but it takes a while to excite the screen. In other words, you have to wake up all those electrons. Same as you did with the CRT, you know, the cathode ray tube TVs. When you turn them on, you know how it came on after a while. The electronic beam has to come on. Well, that's the same way. So it's not drawing any more current than an old one. It's probably drawing the same or less.
What about those new high definition TV sets that they're selling now that are quite expensive? Are they use a lot of electricity?
No. It's just the methodology for the display that's not drawing any more current.
How long from now do you think the prices of those will kind of start dropping down?
Well, they'll start plummeting pretty soon here. Already, Japan's looking at 8K.
Wow.
And 4K is barely out.
Isn't that something?
Yeah, so, and you have to just ask yourself at some time, where do I stop? I mean, I stopped at the 35-inch TV. I was very happy with that. But when a 65-inch TV came down to like $795, you know, and I bought it. And since then, my wife and I have looked at all the different models and all the stores, and they're back up to over 1,000 now. So that we did a good thing on that Black Friday, man. We lucked out like
this, right.
You know,
mm-hmm.
and got the 5-year warranty with it, got everything with it. Mm-hmm. The idea is we didn't want anything that we had to fix.
right.
And like I said earlier, I buy everything from Sears. Why do I do that? I get that warranty. I don't want any problem with the microwave, the stove, the refrigerator, the washer, dryer. No problem. Don't call me.
Thank you, Hugh. Do you know one thing? If you look at the large display screens, like in the middle of a sport arena or on Times Square, if you actually get close to them, the pixels are gigantic.
Yes.
So they're not really a high def. They just look high def from the distance you're at.
Right. You've seen the billboards that you come down the street.
Like, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If you're up close, those are really 14-inch. Well, some are 24-inch. So they're panels. Let's say 24-inch by 24-inch. And they just slide in or snap in. But you see it as one large screen.
So right.
If there's a problem, they just go and take one of those 24-inch panels out and put another one in. But they all talk. Well, those are light bulbs. And the light bulb, depending upon how much voltage you give it, changes the color.
So how big is one of those pixels? I've always wondered, is it like the size of a quarter? It's gigantic compared to what we used to on our close-up screens.
No, they're about the size of a dime.
Oh, my.
Really?
Yeah, each one of those round LEDs is the size of a dime.
Huh. That's still very big compared to what we're looking at.
I think I still have one somewhere that doesn't work. I'll bring it in. Show you the size of it. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
Very interesting.
And do you also help with the emergency backup battery systems, too, when you put in?
The UPSs, yep. Uh-huh. When I was at the Hope House in Gainesville, which is owned by the Cancer Society, not owned, but operated, Winn-Dixie owns it, we had to do that. They had a UPS there, and it wasn't plugged in. I mean, it was plugged in, but it wasn't utilized.
Oh.
And I touched one of the wires, and everything went off.
Oh,
and
no.
And I said, why aren't you plugged into the UPS? I don't know.
Don't you love that answer?
So I said, well, since everything's turned off, the phone's turned off, and because of everything, you know, I hit the power line.
Oh, no.
And by hit, I mean, it was the craziest thing that it was plugged into an outlet that was just hanging there. It's amazing, all these institutions. I'm surprised OSHA doesn't close half of them down for all the safety, you know, violations.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I took it loose. I went ahead and plugged the UPS in. I went ahead and plugged everything into the UPS. Ta-da, they were up.
Oh, my gosh. You're amazing.
Wow. And what does UPS stand for?
Uninterruptible power supply.
Ah, okay.
We need that.
Didn't know if I ever knew or not. I didn't know.
I didn't know.
Jim, always fun to talk to you. Remember, if you want some information about hooking up your devices or perhaps information on what kind of a device, Jim is the guy to call. How do we call you?
You call me at 854-9795. And have a great Valentine's Day.
Yeah, thank you, Jim. You too. All right, we'll take a little break and we'll be right back.
Ocala's Information Station, 1370 WOCA.
Ocala!
The weather is...